Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for coming to Explorations in Culture and Diversity. My name is Pecha, and I'm the coordinator of the Public Scholars Initiative at the Graduate and Postdoctoral Studies right over there here at UBC. So I'd like to begin by acknowledging where we are, the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people, and we're always grateful for that. Today, we're going to hear from an amazing lineup of speakers. They're all UBC doctoral students doing outstanding work that is not only scholarly rigorous, but also seeking to advance the public good. This is why our initiative is called Public Scholars. The clue is in the title. And the talk series is called PhD's Go Public. So I think we're being very obvious. The idea is that doctoral education can engage meaningfully with the public through various interactions and collaborations. This event marks the third of the 2017 PhD's Go Public research talk series, and we've had one on education and one on the environment very recently last week. And in April, we're going to continue with social justice, and in May, we'll conclude with health for 2017. So stay tuned for updates. Just a few notes before we get started. The event is being filmed and photographed, so if you have any concerns about that, please let me know, or our photographer Melinda or Chris, videographer at the back. Please help yourself to the refreshments behind you. They're not too healthy, but I think they're going to do the trick for an afternoon event. And the washrooms are right outside. Finally, we encourage you to take the conversation to Twitter if you like to. We're using the hashtag UBCPSI, which is on the event programs in your hands, and we may have a chance to refer to those as we continue with the event. So the Public Scholars Initiative was born less than 2 years ago with the view to reimagine the PhD experience in closer connection with the communities while at the same time preparing students for a diverse array of careers. So we have many goals. And I've been lucky to be a part of that, the team that built it. First and foremost are Dean Susan Porter, Senior Advisor to the Dean Jenny Phelps, who's not with us today, and more importantly, more than the 80 students in the program, the Public Scholars Initiative. So to talk more about how the PSI began its journey, I'd like to invite Susan Porter to the microphone. You may have a seat over there. We have extra seats.
Thanks very much, F.A., and I would like to thank F.A. as well for being a part of this from the beginning and really formative for the initiative. I think a lot of you probably, just out of interest, how many have not heard of the PSI? Okay, so there's some. So I'll give you, F.A., I think, gave you a very good background. Let me just expand a little bit. So the PhD, or the doctorate in general, was introduced as a concept, as a research degree in the 19th century in America, starting at Yale and then Johns Hopkins. And it was created to in the acknowledgement that received wisdom isn't enough to advance society. We need to explore, create new knowledge, and be rigorous scholars is an important way to advance society in all the disciplines. And the way the PhD was formulated was that the student would have to do some research that would then be written up in a way that was accessible to that person's peers, and that was going to be assessed and put in a library and read by the peers, which are probably maybe 20 to 30 people maybe. Times have changed since the 21st century, since the 19th century. And we now know our scholars, only a minority actually go on to be professors. About 70% do other things. And they are amazing contributors to the world, to society. They are advancing society, but in different ways. So they are not necessarily discovering new knowledge. Sometimes that's definitely a part of what they do. But they are applying knowledge, they are combining knowledge, they are teaching, they are doing all kinds of different ways of doing scholarship. But yet that's not all, it's not usually what we teach them at the university. It's not usually how we assess them. we still assess them, are they able to make a scholarly product that goes in the library? And so this is an attempt to experiment with a different way of thinking about this. Several fields already do this kind of thing, and it's not that novel, perhaps, but a lot of fields don't. And so it's a way of rethinking what scholarship is for a doctoral degree, what scholarship is in society. And so we're encouraging and supporting students to do something outside their box and engage the public and contribute to the public good and learn different ways of doing scholarship, learn to integrate, learn to apply, learn to communicate with the public. And we're not saying this is an add-on that you can do in addition to your real thesis, but this is saying, actually, this is part of what it means to be a PhD. This is part of what we're going to assess you for. And so we are encouraging these students to actually integrate it with their dissertation and be assessed along with everything that they've learned. So I think that's about as much background as I'll give, and I have to say the students that have signed up for this have just been remarkable, and I'm sure you're going to see that today. So thanks.
Thank you, Susan. Before we begin the talks, a big thank you goes to the Irving Tate Barber Learning Center for generously sponsoring the recording of this event, which will be available on their website as part of their educational webcast series, so we're grateful for that too. Okay, so explorations in culture and diversity, what does that even mean? If you look at your event programs, you'll see that 8 doctoral students whose topics and disciplines are seemingly very unrelated. We have anthropologists, theater and opera students, as well as a sociologist and a historian, and interdisciplinary studies. So their topics range from Peruvian mountain communities to Filipino TV audiences. So how does that even make sense to bring them together? So despite such differences, since the first time these students came together, a theme began to emerge, which was last September. And that theme is to explore the richness of various cultures in a scholarly way, and help various voices in different parts of the world to pass down to new generations and spread across different parts of the world, different geographies. So in other words, rigorous research done in collaboration with communities can help culture and diversity flourish. I will be keeping that theme in mind as I'm listening to the talks. Finally, a word on the structure. We'll have 4 speakers, and then we'll have a Q&A, and then we'll give a short break, 4 more speakers, Q&A, and then call it a day. So, shall we begin? When I say the word opera, which country comes to your mind? Just shout out.
Italy.
What was that?
Germany.
Yeah, so, anything else? So, why not Canada? Our first speaker would like to change that perception. She's not only an acclaimed opera singer, which you'll be hearing after her talk, but also, as part of her PhD, she's creating a Canadian opera anthology, and she'll be going on a nationwide recital tour to increase the recognition of Canadian opera. And as I said after her talk, she's going to perform an example of what Canadian opera may sound like. So please welcome Stephanie Nakagawa from Musical Arts and Voice Opera.
Afternoon. So yes, my research is on Canadian opera, and I'm an opera singer. More specifically, opera created by Canadian composers and lyricists. So FA sort of did this for me, but how many of you are familiar with the Italian opera La Traviata? Can you raise your hand? A lot of you, great. How about Mozart's Magic Flute? A lot too. Okay, how many of you know the Canadian opera Philomena? 1. That's pretty good. 2. Pretty good. Okay. Well, you're not alone. Even for my colleagues, it's a struggle to name more than a few Canadian operas. What's really surprising is that there are actually 400 Canadian operas out there, and this number only continues to grow today. One of the reasons Canadian opera is relatively unknown is that once premiered, these works rarely receive additional performances. Canadian operas are also rarely published, so their scores get lost or they remain as handwritten manuscripts, as seen here. In other words, even if singers want to perform Canadian opera, they will have a hard time finding the music. For my research, I have created a Canadian opera aria anthology for soprano. Basically, this is a book of arias for singers' use in auditions and performances. To do so, I took excerpts from operas and adapted them into solo pieces. This anthology not only includes the adapted aria scores, but it also contains background information about the operas, such as performance histories, cast lists, and opera synopses. In addition, I have also written interpretive guides based on my own research in performing these pieces and from personal interviews with the composers and lyricists. As part of my public scholarship, I have been presenting lecture recitals across Canada to introduce my anthology and perform some of the arias within it for new audiences. In a few weeks, my pianist and I will be performing for opera students at the University of Manitoba and at Toronto's Tapestry Opera, a company that is leading the way for the creation of new Canadian works. My research aims to increase the awareness, accessibility, and performance of Canadian opera. So right now, North American opera companies require singers to audition with contemporary English works. This is because they want to see how well singers can communicate in English and how well they can perform modern style music. About 99% of the time, singers sing American or British operas. In fact, before I started this research, I had never even considered singing Canadian opera. Why? Well, because I barely knew of any, and because it was too difficult to find the scores. So through singers' performances of these Canadian works, opera companies and audiences will become more familiar and aware with them. And hopefully, someday, they will return to the operatic stage. And right now, there seems to be an increasing interest in Canadian opera, and here it's being featured on Canada Post's 150th celebration stamps. It's important that we strive to preserve Canadian opera as it reflects our culture and society. Musicologist Mary Ingraham suggests that the genre as a whole serves as an important Canadian cultural artifact. Singers, opera companies, and audiences should support the creation and nurture the development of Canadian opera. For example, many of the operas within my anthology tell stories based on Canadian historical figures. Probably the most famous and historically significant Canadian opera is Louis Riel by Harry Summers and Mabel Moore. This opera is unique in the fact that it reflects Canada's multiculturalism by blending together three languages, French, English, and Cree. Its music also serves to preserve Canada's musical heritage through the integration of traditional folk melodies from the Red River settlement. Two other operas, written by John Estacio and John Morrell, reveal the hidden stories of two extraordinary women in Canadian history. So Philomena, the first and only woman ever to be hung in Alberta, and Lillian Alling, a mysterious woman who walked alone from New York to British Columbia in the 1920s. Another opera, Mary's Wedding, depicts the life of a young Saskatchewan farm boy who enlists in World War I. It also sheds remembrance on the life of Canadian Lieutenant Gordon Flowerdew, who was posthumously awarded the Victoria Cross for his great bravery. As you can see, my anthology not only aims to give singers a new and exciting repertoire for auditions and performances, but it also gives Canadian singers the opportunity to connect with and showcase their own cultural identity in operatic form. It's my hope that through these works, singers and audiences will have a lens through which they may better understand Canadian opera and culture. A new project has developed from this research, which I'm very excited about. The Canadian Music Centre and I are working towards publishing an anthology book series of Canadian operas for each voice type. If you're interested in learning more about this research, please come to my lecture recital, which will be held at the UBC Old Auditorium on April 12th at 3 p.m. So thank you very much for your time. And now my pianist, Bence, and I would like to perform one of the arias from this anthology for you. This is I Need You, Guillaume, from The Transit of Venus by Victor Davies and Maureen Hunter, which premiered at Manitoba Opera in 2007. Celeste has waited 6 years for her lover, Guillaume, to return from his expeditions in India. Now that he has come back, she thinks they can finally start their life together. Instead, however, Guillaume asks her to wait yet again for him while he goes off on another quest. In this aria, she begs him to stay with her.
Can you believe that this is a free event? Coffee and tea are free. Moving on. Our next speaker will be talking about these beautiful textiles that you may see around the room. Actually, do we have more?
Yeah, they're being passed out at the back. So there'll be five at the back that can slowly be passed towards the
So these textiles are produced by the local and traditional Quechua communities in the Peruvian Andes. Yet, with the increased demand of tourism and mechanized production of textiles, these communities are facing a threat to lose their livelihood as well as cultural heritage. Our next speaker studies the complex political, economic, and legal realities in the region to help empower these communities continue their tradition and livelihood. Please welcome Ashley Akins from Interdisciplinary Studies.
Everybody. As F.A. said, my name is Ashley Akins, and I'm a PhD student in interdisciplinary studies at the Liu Institute for Global Issues, combining anthropology, law, and environmental studies. So I have passed around a few textiles for you to look at. They'll be coming from the back towards the front. And these were woven by indigenous Quechua women in Peru who live in remote subsistence communities over 4,000 meters above sea level, deep in the Andean Mountains near Machu Picchu. And these textiles are hand-woven by memory on backstrap looms with knowledge that has been passed down generation after generation from elder to youth. They are made with alpaca or sheep fiber and dyed with plants and other natural pigments from the region. The symbols embedded in these weavings tell a story. To me, these textiles act as a history book, a way for the Quechua women to tell their own stories with their hands and their hearts, which is especially important at a time when their stories are so well documented by outsiders, but so rarely heard through their own voices. Once I learned how to read these textiles, I learned a new language. One of my favorite symbols is the hummingbird in the bottom right there, the kente, two birds feeding one another, which means reciprocity and rebirth for new life. Though these textiles have been a cultural cornerstone for centuries, they are now struggling to stay alive as machine-made synthetic knockoffs flood marketplaces. Weavers cannot sell their products for fair prices, for a price that actually embeds the traditional knowledge, the skills, and the time that it takes to keep this tradition alive. And many youth don't want to be associated with being Quechua for fear that they will have less educational and employment opportunities due to discrimination. I have been working with Quechua weavers in the Andean Mountains for the past 11 years. A few years ago, during a community meeting that I was facilitating for Moskoy, the charitable organization that I work with, some weavers thought it would be a good idea to create an authenticity certificate to increase the value of their products and to teach consumers the difference between the real product and those which were the knockoffs. I remember having a conversation with my colleague at the time, and we both thought it sounded like a great idea, but that it was actually a huge undertaking and much more complex than our small grassroots organization could actually handle at the time. I remember saying, man, we would actually need to hire a doctoral student to take that on. So, years later, here I am. As part of my research, I will be undergoing a feasibility study to see if such a thing could actually exist. A collective, community-owned authenticity certification process, which could be specific to a particular cultural heritage or tradition like the Quechua textiles. The complexity comes in when you begin asking the questions. What is authenticity? Who gets to decide? Which adaptations of cultural heritage would be considered authentic and which wouldn't? What if one community disagrees with another? For example, one community that I work with still shears their own alpacas and spins their fiber by hand using a push spindle. But the other communities along that same mountain range no longer have access to alpacas, and so they purchase machine-spun fiber. So I will be examining these types of questions through a variety of methodologies, including multi-stakeholder interviews and surveys. To ground this a bit for you, textiles are one of many forms that are officially defined internationally as intangible cultural heritage. So intangible cultural heritage is essentially anything that is traditional knowledge passed down through generations, often orally, that is important for a culture. So this could include language, music, poetry, visual art, dance, theater, rituals, ceremonies, legends, fairy tales, things like that. Cultural heritage is threatened around the world and continues to decline. The Quechua textile tradition is but one of many examples. In the Himalayas, for example, traditional Tibetan medicine faces dichotomies between its traditional local medicine and commodified standardized forms on the global marketplace. Here in Canada, First Nations communities face similar threats to their languages and arts every single day. These questions are part of a much larger inquiry regarding collective intellectual property rights. Laws were set up in a capitalist society in and for a primarily Western context, which sees human rights as individual rights. But cultural heritage, like many concepts that stem from indigenous worldviews, are seen through a collective lens. So how then can we use these policies in a way that can actually protect cultural heritage on the ground level? Though the aim of my research is to safeguard cultural heritage against threats of disappearance, and especially in the face of power imbalances, I am cautious that many safeguarding mechanisms inadvertently stagnate cultural heritage. They museumify traditions, putting them on a shelf to be preserved in a static, archaic form. So by protecting tradition, there is often little room for adaptation, for living heritage to breathe, to as its culture and community adapts, grows, and develops. Cultural heritage is part of a human community, which means it naturally adapts so that it can be more resilient in the face of challenges. This is how all systems, all cultures evolve, to be less vulnerable to threats. However, not all adaptations are healthy, and many adaptations are imposed on communities and artists. Community agency, so choice, vote, and decision-making power, plays a large role in navigating that complex question of adaptation. There are dozens of laws and legislations that safeguard cultural heritage internationally. However, many of these safeguarding mechanisms aren't actually felt locally at the community level. From my experience, the producers that I work with care much more about the market and the consumers. This is where they feel that concrete change can actually happen. So after researching the legal side of safeguarding mechanisms in my master's degree, I am now wanting to look at consumer values and how consumers themselves can act as safeguarding mechanisms for cultural heritage. Travelers often ask me, where can I go to buy authentic textiles? Where can I go to actually support the artists? So as one of my many community outputs, I will be designing a free tourist map of the region, which will be available to travelers in print and online, featuring the key distributors that sell authentic products. I'm partnering with a network of NGOs to update the map on an annual basis to ensure its relevance and comprehensiveness after I graduate. I've also been working in collaboration with graphic artist Lydia Beauregard to produce a booklet documenting the story of the textile, which will accompany all textiles that consumers buy from one of my partnering NGOs, Moskoi's Peruvian Textiles, so that the embedded value of cultural heritage is better understood by the consumer. Though I will primarily be working with Quechua weavers, I will also be working with artists in three other satellite sites around the world to see how other communities have responded and adapted to these global challenges. This is a global problem. It's a phenomenon that I hear from so many artists and culture bearers around the world who believe in their cultural heritage so much, but who also want to participate in the changes and the development that they see in their communities. They simply want to do so in their own way, with agency and with choice. Before I conclude, I would like to acknowledge the scholarships that have supported my research, the Vanier Canada Graduate Scholarship, the Faculty of Graduate Studies and the Public Scholars Initiative, the Lew Institute for Global Issues, and my program, the Interdisciplinary Studies Graduate Program. I would also like to acknowledge the support of my supervisors, Dr. Wade Davis and Dr. Kai Chan, as well as my committee members, Dr. Mark Turin and Dr. Nancy Turner. I would especially like to thank my partner organization, Moskoi, and the weavers who have embarked upon this research with me in the communities of Amaru, Parobamba, Pichukiska, Kancha Kancha, and Waran. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Ashley. We've heard about Canadian opera, but what about Canadian theater? As a multicultural nation, theater in Canada owes a lot to masters and traditions from other parts of the world. Two such figures are Étienne de Grou from France and Jerzy Grotowski from Poland. Their influence on Canadian theater has been understudied until now. Our next speaker traces the lineages of these masters, and you'll notice that she also has a very personal, familial connection with that heritage. Please welcome Claire Fogel from theater.
Hi, I'm Claire. I'm, as F.A. said, from the Department of Theater and Film. I'm here to talk about my dad and physical theater. When I was born in Paris 44 years ago, my dad, Dean Fogel, was studying a special form of physical theater. Since then, with incredible tenacity, he's taught and evolved that form here in Vancouver, consistently running a studio despite our crazy real estate prices, and steadily amassing creative wealth that he's passed down to me. But all of Dad's studios have disappeared. He founded Room to Move at Oak and Broadway with 20 instructors teaching everything you might want to study, and it was knocked down to make room for a new 7-Eleven. His studio on 4th Avenue was replaced by a pet grooming salon. For 15 years, we ran a school called Tuba Physical Theater Center. When our building on 12th Avenue was demolished so posh condos could be built, we salvaged our floors and installed them in the Dominion Building here on East Hastings, transforming unrented old storage rooms into beautiful studios. The landlord then tripled our rent, and when BC Gaming decided to withhold funds from arts groups, we had to close our doors. My father's experience then has been of fighting to preserve and grow one of the world's richest repositories of knowledge about physical expression and the body's vast capacity from a base that was constantly disappearing in a city that didn't appear to value his attempts. My dissertation celebrates my father's work and the creative treasure he's given me. The perpetual existence in our lives of an empty room, a bare space with a wood floor, quietly but powerfully affirmed the value of creation, of freedom of expression, of imagination, and ongoing learning. My father's work, which is a method of making the invisible visible, is called corporeal mime. Dad's teacher, Etienne de Creux, invented the form of corporeal mime in France to liberate the full expressive capacity of the human body to convey our inner life. Deploring pantomime as trite, comic, and literal, de Creux's corporeal mime was abstract, serious, and archetypal. He was building a bodily system to train humanity not to be bystanders, but to stand up and consider alignment, not only physically, but also philosophically. Corporeal mime seeks to enhance alertness, honesty, sensitivity, and courage. And de Creux felt that if it survived, then the world would survive. But my father's evolution of de Creux's work is not the only focus of my research. The other half of my creative inheritance comes through my mentor of 27 years, Kathleen Weiss, who co-founded Tuba with my dad in order to blend his corporeal mime with the Gratowski-based work that was her focus. Jerzy Gratowski's laboratory theater had managed to do incredibly brave, rebellious, and vulnerable work under the noses of state censors in communist Poland for 25 years, creating theater that was actually an antidote to totalitarianism. Gratowski sought to cultivate the essence of theater, the moment of honest and courageous exchange between human beings. Like de Creux's corporeal mime, his poor theater celebrates the power of an actor's body to transform before our very eyes, unassisted by fancy lighting, costumes, or special effects. Gratowski's commitment to inspiring agency and true communication was so pronounced that at the height of his company's international fame, he chose to stop producing shows and move instead into paratheatrical research, in part because he felt that the passive role allotted to spectators within theatrical convention left them no real option other than that of bystanders, and that was unacceptable after what had happened to the Jews in Poland. At Lascaux, human beings left their handprints and paintings of animals as an enduring legacy of their intelligence, creativity, and reverence for the world. In a theater studio, it's the reverse. The countless foot and handprints of artistic inspiration, that studio's vibrant repertoire of human expression, are invisible. As theater researchers, both de Creux and Gratowski passed on their knowledge orally and through physical practice, spending their lives on the floors of their studios in a quest for absolute corporeal integrity. Luckily, their work brought international recognition, and dozens of books are written on their accomplishments. My teachers, too, are masters of the studio floor, having spent decades evolving this research, rendering it more humane, filling in gaps, and taking it in important new directions. Though each of them is celebrated by the hundreds of students that they've taught over the years, none of their work is documented. My dissertation will shine a spotlight on the innovations of my teachers and of all the artists in Western Canada who are continuing the work begun by DeCru and Gratowski. Embedding video footage directly into my dissertation will, of course, totally enhance my ability to convey their wealth of physical knowledge and the detailed methodologies that they've evolved. My plan unfurls in phases. In June, my father and I head to France to dig down to the roots of these forms in various archives and trade knowledge with European members of these lineages to be able to compare Canadian developments from a broader context. I'll film my dad explaining his work outside of DeCru's old Paris studio. Next summer, I'll bring together six of Western Canada's most senior and least documented artists to discuss their unique contributions and share knowledge through collective embodied practice. With my father and many of my mentors now in their 60s and 70s, I'm eager to initiate and film this in-depth exchange. I'll also search throughout Western Canada to interview all the artists belonging to these lineages through email and compile as complete a directory as possible so that future students know where to find this work. I want to build a network amongst these artists since there's strength in numbers and validation within community. All of this work, connecting abroad, hosting locally, and reaching out across Western Canada, will seed the ground for a larger conference that I'll host, featuring a learning circle, public talks, demonstrations, performances, and a workshop series to make this work more widely accessible and hopefully globally appreciated. Our artists deserve to emerge from obscurity and take their place on the world stage. My dissertation is a vehicle to spark cultural dialogue, foster connections between artists, and put Western Canadian innovations within two of the world's richest theater studio traditions on record to ensure their ongoing impact. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. How do we teach new generations to feel empathy for fellow human beings, especially in a world where not caring about others seems to be rewarded, at least in presidential elections? So our next speaker studies empathy. She looks at how museums and schools represent human violence, such as genocide and other types of conflict, with a view to create a better human rights education in Canada and around the world. Please welcome Lily Ivanova from Sociology.
Thank you very much, Effie, for that introduction. As he mentioned, I'm a PhD student in sociology who is interested in culture and memory. Through this project, I'm interested in advancing two primary questions. So my first question is, how do we teach individuals who haven't experienced human rights abuses, how do we teach a new generation to understand histories of violence, as well as how do we teach groups of individuals who haven't experienced this violence in their communities about the human rights abuses that other communities have faced in the past? So I wanted to begin with a little bit of background on some of the international efforts there have been for genocide education. So this is, in 2015, UNESCO created a Holocaust education report, which primarily traced how different nations around the world are commemorating the Holocaust. So you can see in the dark red is nations who are including this in their curriculums, and then this moves towards the white, where the Holocaust is not taught. What's interesting about this is that the UNESCO uses the Holocaust as a proxy to show how genocide education is taught, but there isn't much attention to whether other genocides are taught. So the report focuses on the Holocaust, as many of UNESCO's projects have tended to do, rather than potentially more regionally relevant events. So I want to take you through five of my case studies that I'm pursuing for my dissertation research. Two of them are Holocaust concentration camps. Two are memorial museums in other countries. And then I'm bringing all of this together to try and inform some of the policies of the Canadian Museum for Human Rights. So as many of you probably recognize, this image is from Auschwitz-Birkenau Memorial and Museum in Poland, which is likely the largest, the most frequented concentration camp. Over 1.5 million people visit this camp annually. And this is also the hub for a lot of the institutes that are teaching about memorializing genocide. So they consult a lot of other concentration camps and other memorial centers around the world. This is Dachau concentration camp memorial site in Dachau near Munich in Germany. This is probably the second most visited concentration camp in Europe. I'm also looking at the Cambodian genocide sites. I don't know if any of you have heard of these or been recently, as Cambodia has become more of a tourist hotspot on the Southeast Asia backpacker circuit. So a lot of young people especially are going to these memorial sites in Phnom Penh. This is the Kigali Genocide Memorial Center in Rwanda. It was set up in 2004 by a UK NGO. It was done in consultation with the Rwandan government, but interestingly enough, primarily set up by this NGO that consults for genocide education. Bringing this to the Canadian Museum for Human Rights, which is in Manitoba, maybe some of you have visited there. It was set up in 2013, and it looks to represent multiple human rights abuses. So it includes displays on the Holocaust, but also atrocities in Canada, like the residential schools. So apart from looking at the sites themselves, my research is also largely looking at how individuals understand genocides as they learn about them in these centers. So this is a shot from the killing fields in Cambodia where I did interviews, and I'm looking to expand my interview analysis in other areas. I wanted to begin by pointing out some of the conventions in memorializing genocide. Many of you might be familiar with images like this. In the top left is the portrait gallery in Auschwitz. Similar style of representing genocide is found in Dachau on the top right. And you can see this as well in Cambodia. These are mugshots of prisoners that museum visitors see on the walls. And a similar strategy is seen in Rwanda. But interestingly enough, not all of these strategies emerge organically. So for example, in the case of Cambodia, two US journalists found the negatives for these photos, and they were first displayed in 1997 at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And they were only later brought to Tuol Sleng. So we see these networks of conventions in memorializing, traveling around between sites. You're probably also familiar with some of these collections of objects that can be found at genocide sites. In the top left is Auschwitz again, the collection of shoes, famously as well. There are glass displays filled with hair, prosthetic limbs, other objects that were collected to show the magnitude of the violence. And we can see a similar strategy being followed in Cambodia. This is a glass case full of clothing. And in Rwanda, you can also see clothing is displayed as a way to connect visitors to those who've experienced who died in this atrocity. But interestingly enough, this again is passed through these networks of global actors commemorating these cases. So the Kigali Memorial Center, set up by the British NGO, the director of the British NGO is also the director of the National Holocaust Center and Museum in the UK. So we can see how some of these strategies for commemoration are traveling through specific individuals and organizations. I wanted to speak a little bit about cases where we don't see the conventions being followed. So in the top left and right, you'll see at Auschwitz a gas chamber, and on the right is a crematorium in Dachau. So these are very familiar symbols for us in understanding the Holocaust. But these are not found in other cases of genocide. So in the bottom left, there's a very famous display at the killing fields of the killing tree, which says against which executioners beat children. And this is usually found by my interviewees as a very kind of disturbing understanding of how people died in this event compared to what they understand to be conventional ways of killing people in a genocide through the Holocaust images of gas chambers. On the right, we have, in the case of the Rwandan sites, there's images showing how machetes impacted skulls, which again visitors find quite disturbing and outside of their understanding of genocide. Here we also see skulls, which are present at both sites. So in Cambodia above, there's a map of skulls, which was very controversial and has since been taken down. Now the skulls are in a stupa. But visitors again find this as potentially a little bit of a crass way to represent the experiences of victims. In Rwanda, we see this again. I'm working on trying to find a way that we can commemorate genocides in ways that preserve the uniqueness of these different cases without necessarily washing over the unique elements of each case by applying these international conventions. So one place that takes up this mission is actually UBC in a program about that educates undergraduate students on Auschwitz. And the whole intention of this program is to challenge some of these mainstream understandings of the Holocaust by bringing in more diversity in the types of stories we hear about this. We can see this also happening at the Canadian Museum for Human Rights. This is an exhibition they had in 2015, ended in 2016, The Witness Blanket, again trying to show the diverse experiences of residential school survivors. So that's it for my presentation, and thank you so much for listening.
We have been asked to quickly summarize the questions for the sake of the video. So just because the video, I guess, can't hear the audience. So she has asked about the difference between the enacted cultural heritage and that that is behind glass in a museum, and what that looks like for the weavers in Peru, and how they enact their cultural heritage in their weavings. So what I have seen is the intangible side of that. And so the process that is passed down that is not necessarily the end product. And so you can put the weaving behind glass in a museum and say that that is preserving cultural heritage, but that doesn't preserve the knowledge that is passed down from elder to youth. That doesn't preserve the fact that the child goes out and picks the plants with the elder and learns how to cultivate those plants and where those plants come from and how to dye those plants in the boiling pots and then how to shear the alpaca, how to use a pushka, a spindle. And all of that process and then warping the loom and how that's done with two women, not one, and how that is an act of reciprocity that they both warp each other's looms before they actually start weaving. And then they weave, and that then is remembered through watching and through storytelling. It's not written down, it's not drawn. And so all of that is knowledge transmission that is enacted by living it, by watching it, by sharing it, and by passing that down. And it can be documented, it can be written, but that is not the same as feeling it and living it. The question is there any chance a video could be made to share that process? That's actually been a big question for oral traditions, is what are other ways of documenting that can be more inclusive for communities that are non-written, that are communities of non-written languages, in a way that they can actually participate in the viewing process? Because documenting a language or a culture or a cultural heritage in a written book is not inclusive for someone who is part of an oral language or a non-written language. And so video has been something that can potentially be used for that. I would not say personally to replace it in any way, but in an effort to share and to be part of knowledge sharing among communities and also to educate about how important this cultural heritage is. There is also an element of accessibility as well, though, that regarding video and ability to actually have the technology to watch the videos. But I do think it is definitely an avenue towards that.
Thank you for that question. So the question was whether you can share something sacred, like a cultural process on a mass scale. Did I understand that correctly? So yes, I think that is a very, very good question, especially in my case, because especially for Holocaust education, educators are now coming to the point where, you know, they're saying this new generation will be the first generation without direct access to the experiences of survivors as they age and pass away. And I think it's very valid to ask how we should be moving forward in this. And I think some of the solutions they're coming up with do focus on putting individuals in direct contact with the sacred in more sort of profound attempts to engage with the question. So especially with museum studies, I get the question a lot, if you know someone goes to a museum one time, is that really going to change how they think about an event? So I think the solution is introducing these sort of education strategies throughout people's lives. So there's more emphasis now on, you know, genocide education in elementary schools. So just ensuring that people have adequate amount of exposure to these ideas to work through them directly in many different forums. So I think that might be one way, but I think it is a very good question, and we can keep thinking about new ways to do this.
I think for mine, it's a little bit different in the sense that with cultural heritage, I think it's really community and culture dependent, and I think it depends on what the community wants. And I think for me, I think a big part of it is, I think sharing knowledge in a wider scale is important for the sake of educating about the value of it, educating about why does cultural heritage matter, and why is that a valuable, why is cultural diversity valuable, why is cultural heritage important in our lives, and why should we care that communities around the world are working on these seemingly isolated artistic practices around the world. But that to me is that to me can preserve the sacred without teaching people how to weave. I think when you try to teach people the inside scoop, in a way, of a tradition, that becomes potentially a violation or potentially diminishes the sacred practice of a tradition. And I think that really becomes when it absolutely needs to be about community agency and the cultural agency of what that particular community and culture wants about their heritage and whether or not they want to share that, and that could diminish the sacredness of that when it becomes mass produced, I think.
Well, unfortunately, we'll have to move forward. So please join me in thanking the first four presenters.
So our next talk will not be a talk. It's going to be a short film, and a very high quality one at that. The film is a story of immigration. Again, another very timely topic. How do immigrants create their social meanings in a new country and hold on to their cultural identity from home? The film looks at the case of Russian immigrants to the West in the 20th century and argues that material things that remind us of home is important for immigrants. So, after this movie was sent to me by the director that I'll be introducing in a minute, I thought of what kind of material artifacts that I keep around to remind me of my home. Some of you may know that I'm originally from Turkey, and my hometown is called Smyrna. Smyrna historically, today is called Izmir. So I looked around my workstation and I saw that I have one of these. It's a postcard from Izmir, And it's a clock tower which was built in 1901. So I had not even realized that I keep these things around until I saw the movie. So the film is specifically made for this event. So it's not just any video that I will be showing you. So as he called it, it's world premiere. And it's made by Gregory Den, documentary filmmaker and a PhD student in anthropology.
My memories? In my childhood, I were a bit of a
jump. I was born in the Soviet Union.
Yeah, I'm Canadian. I remember. Last time I was in Moscow, I discovered my grandfather's slides. He took his camera and went to a neighborhood slated to be demolished. And he took hundreds of photos with hardly any people in them, just the buildings. I think he wanted to extend their lives.
Вещи, они периодически вызывают шок. Я помню, как раз когда вернулся из Канады, то полез на антресоли и стал вынимать оттуда какие-то вещи, про которые я вообще забыл уже абсолютно. То есть они были для меня уже абсолютно чужие. И тут они на меня опять свалились, потому что я не понимал, что с ними делать. Как бы я уже перешел в другую жизнь, фактически, уехав в Канаду, а потом вернувшись, я дважды умер. Этот предмет связан, как я уже потом понял, с моей мамой. Вот. То есть это была ее первоначальная игрушка вот, в ее детстве. То есть это какие-то 30-е годы. Когда мне было лет 10 или 11, то есть достаточно уже большой мальчик, вот. Я вдруг нашел эту мишку, и я стал, значит, с этим мишкой там завтракать, сажать его рядом с собой на стол. Там, в общем, были такие очень нежные отношения, это я его укладывал спать. Вот. Так что этот вот объект, этот мишка, он очень напоминает мне и о маме с нежностью, и вот об этом интересном периоде в своей жизни.
Армения, откуда я родом, как бы страна, почитающая кофе. Там девушки должны уметь варить кофе. Это целый ритуал, это все очень сложно. Я этому училась и научилась. Вот. А потом во мне появились такие всякие современные феминистические взгляды. Я решила, что вот я не должна этого делать. Потом ко мне стали приезжать всякие гости из России. Вот они все были помешаны на варке кофе, на джезве, и все возмущались, что как это у меня нет этой джезвы, и что они лишены этого кофе по утрам. Поэтому я заказала привезти мне эту джезву из Армении именно для этих гостей. Я помню мой шок, когда произошло землетрясение, такое большое было землетрясение в Армении, и в том городе, где жили мои родители, тоже была, да, одна из больших амплитуд. Но я тогда сходила, посмотрела на свою школу, она стояла, и я была очень рада. И вот 5 лет назад я туда поехала, уже столько времени прошло. Представляете, вот идете вы куда-то, знаете, вот с детства здание, вдруг его нет. Все-таки школа во время землетрясения страдала, что-то там треснуло, и через несколько лет рухнуло. Ты идешь в какое-то место, заворачиваешь, и нет этого здания, которое ты ожидал увидеть, и совершенно другое здание стоит. Ну, вот, поэтому нет ощущения, что ты вернулся туда, откуда уезжал. Вернулся в другое место.
He used to collect stamps. And when I sit to look through them, it's as if we're having a conversation. Not across space, but through time.
Как говорят, у нас из ситуации, которая в России сейчас сложилась, есть три выхода: Шереметьево, Внуково и Домодедово. Нет, я не космополит, я себя чувствую исключительно западноевропейским человеком. Вот, по взглядам на жизнь, там, по культуре, по бытовой культуре. То есть я чувствую, что я по менталитету я гораздо ближе к Западной Европе, чем к России. Мои первые четки, которые со мной уже много лет. Ну, я их купил, ну, наверное, лет 13 назад, когда йогой стал заниматься. Вот, но так как я православный человек, православные молитвы по ним читаю, то я, естественно, к ним приделал крест. Ну, смотри, у меня есть выбор. Есть вот эти, как самые, собственно, основные мои, которые со мной много лет. Ну, в общем, я бы сказал, всю такую сознательную жизнь, да. А есть вот эти, которые связано с Парижем. Это вот откуда едем, грубо говоря. Вот это вот откуда. А это куда? А это книга домашних рецептов. И здесь записаны рецепты, которые переходили от моей мамы, от моей тещи, от моей бабушки. И самые ценные вещи, которые у нас были, это те самые рецепты, которые сохраняют преемственность семьи. Я уже думал о том, что остается нам от родителей, от дома, от прошлого рецепты. Когда умерла моя мама, то я выяснил, что я никогда больше не съем фаршированную рыбу. И мы с моим другом школьным тщательно восстановили рецепт наших мам и приготовили фаршированную рыбу. И здесь есть рецепт фаршированной рыбы, который делала наша мама.
There was something called chowant. Roasted potatoes with roasted lima beans and roasted breast of beef. It was absolutely delicious. And my older brother, who has passed away, used to say to me, "You know, Philly, I never had cholent since Mama passed away. Nobody makes it." I was aware that my parents came from Russia. I grew up in a neighborhood which can never be replaced, I don't think. As a kid in Brooklyn in those days, when I was very young, my mother could give me a quarter and I could go to Botnovsky's Kosher Delicatessen on St. John's Place and get two frankfurters with mustard and sauerkraut, a bottle of soda, and I could still go to the movies and see two full-length features, the Fox Movie Tone News, and a serial to be continued each week. And that was all for the same 25-cent piece. Papa was in World War I. Me and my older brother were in World War II. This was during World War II when I was in the United States Air Force, and this is when I was a volunteer on a special mission. This is a pass. And it's in English, signed by General Schnurl. And here it is in Chinese, I think. I can't see.
and J trains.
I guess I've extended the space of my home to the point where I can no longer find it. Travel became routine. Stability, found in the intimacy of familiar places, in a myriad of little trinkets. This became exceptional. Okay.
This is the second time in this event where I felt like crying a bit. So thank you, Stephanie and Gregory, for doing that. And we're back to Canadian theatre. We talked about the European influences on Canadian theatre, but how about the Asian influences on Canadian theatre? Luckily, we have a speaker for that too. He's a performer himself and merges performance with research to examine the various contributions made by artists of Asian descent to Canadian theatre. And this is particularly valuable for challenging stereotypes and creating dynamic intercultural relationships. Please welcome Yuri Chang from theatre.
Thank you very much. I hope everyone can hear me. So my name is Yuri Chang, and I am actually trained as an actor and director, and I'd like to tell you a short story of how I came to this point. Actually, this is a photo of myself, and I usually don't show photos of myself in performance, but I'm quite proud of this photo because it was taken in 1997, and I was part of the first cast to perform here at the Chan Center for Performing Arts in the BC TELUS studio, and we inaugurated the studio with one of David Henry Wong's plays. And so my research into Asian Canadian theater begins with the notion that Asian migration to Canada dates back to at least 1850s. And despite this fact, the representation of Asian stories or Asian Canadian stories is very limited. Many English language theaters in Canada have a history of importing plays from the UK and from America. And since our canon in Canada tends to be Euro-American in tone. And up until relatively recently, and I'm speaking mainly about 1980s and beyond, mainly public-funded theaters in Canada have produced plays written by Americans, Europeans, and increasingly European Canadians. But now, with the establishment of the Equity Office for Canada Council, some of the faces that you'll be seeing on Canadian stages has changed. So how do I go about my research? I begin with the notion that Asian Canadian theater was very much born out of a kind of pro-nationalist movement that began in the 60s and 70s here in Canada. As we know, Canadian theater promoted the idea that we needed to hear some of our own indigenous stories born out of our urban centers. And specifically, I trace my roots back to 1971, not only when I was born, but when Pierre Elliott Trudeau introduced the multicultural policy of Canada. It was later enacted, as you know, as a Multiculturalism Act in 1982. And since then, I believe that the multicultural rhetoric and the value systems has influenced Canadian theater and produced a Latin American, Latin Canadian theater, an Asian Canadian theater, and an indigenous Canadian theater as well. And so one of the interesting things about Asian Canadian theater is that it's a relatively undocumented field. One of my early mentors at the master's level, Jerry Wasserman, actually sat me down for coffee before I entered graduate studies. And he looked at me and he said, thank you very much for coming to UBC. I'd like to welcome you to theater studies, the last bastion of Eurocentrism here. And he said it partly tongue-in-cheek, but he also said to me, as he looked into my eyes, welcome and good luck. And so from that point on, I decided to continue my studies at the doctoral level. And I've just become a PhD candidate. And now I look specifically at theater made by Canadians of either Chinese or Japanese descent. Why is this important? Well, there's a couple things that I'd like to talk to you about, and that is the idea of qualitative research in theater. Right now, there are many articles published on Asian Canadian theater, but there's no historical research that looks at the evolution of the movement since the late 70s and early 80s. So I intend to employ an array of qualitative research strategies. One is interviewing pioneers and artists in the field, Jean Yoon, Beverly Yap, Rick Shiomi, and current practitioners such as Nina Lee Aquino and Inge Choi, based in Toronto, as well as those based in Vancouver, such as Tetsuro Shigematsu. In the arts, the idea of succession, or building upon the knowledge of previous generations, is now recognized as a necessary process of maintaining cultural history and infrastructure. And I believe that my dissertation will be the first to document 30, 35 years of contributions from these professional theater artists. So right now, you're looking at some photos from a play by David Yee. And right now, there's two characters. And Danny on the left says to Sylvia, another protagonist, "My half and half card, my queen of sparks, half and half, just like me, just like me." That's from David Yee, a Governor General Award winner. Now, of course, Danny is speaking of his dual heritage. His father, Lochran, is a Caucasian man, and his mother comes from Chinese heritage. The intercultural aesthetics are further represented by the visual metaphor in the word sparks, which signifies both card suits, the Queen of Hearts and the Queen of Spades. So in this particular play, the visual metaphor espoused by the character supports a Brechtian moment of learning about intercultural relationships. The playwright himself has a Scottish mother and a Chinese father. So this play gestures subtly towards the policies of the Head Tax Exclusion Act and the anti-miscegenation laws and fears of the early 20th century. This is a photo of myself with a cast, mainly BFA actors here at UBC. This was the play Holy Crab, a Cinephone playwriting contest winner. And this is a post-show talk that I led here at the Dorothy Somerset Studio at UBC. How am I engaging the public? Well, in addition to research, standard academic forums, such as peer-reviewed articles and attending conferences, I engage in artist talkbacks such as those. I also am building a website, www.asiancanadiantheatre.ca. Please look out for the soft launch on May 1st, and as September of this year, we'll be adding videos and a research database of all Asian Canadian playwrights, directors, and actors across Canada, but specifically those working in Vancouver and Toronto. If you have any questions and you'd like to join me on this upward journey, feel free to email me, yuri.chang@alumni@ubc.ca. Thank you very much.
So who likes to watch Netflix here? Can I see some show of hands? Yeah? Only on this side? Just like, hates Netflix. Yeah, Netflix and chill. That's an expression. For academics, there's a different one. They say Netflix and guilt. Did you hear about that? Whenever you watch Netflix, you feel guilt. So whatever your favorite show is, think about it in your mind right now. But also be prepared, because our next speaker invites us to think of our experience with TV or mass media in general in a more critical dimension. Especially in relation to the larger social and political power relations. How can media, mass media, seek to create an economic market, a public, even a nation? His case study is the Philippines in the mid-20th century. But I think the story we're going to hear has many implications for viewers anywhere today. Please welcome Ty Paradella from History.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Efe, for that introduction, and thank you all for joining us today. I want to begin my presentation by asking you to recall your experiences of being an audience. And I want you to let this questionnaire guide you in your recollections. This is a page from a survey from 1968 that I am using for my dissertation. I study mass media audiences in the Philippines in the mid-20th century. The Public Scholars Initiative has allowed me to explore ways of engaging directly the audiences who are in my historical research. And this project is what I'll be talking about today. Who are these audiences? As media systems and communication infrastructures were restored in the Philippines after the Second World War ended in the Pacific in 1945, communication researchers began asking the people on how they were exposed to the mass media. In their pioneering endeavors, communication research generated huge amounts of data on mass media audiences. The local elites would in turn use this data to craft policies and programs not only to communicate to the audiences, but also to constitute them as markets, publics, and even a nation. In 1946, barely a year after the war ended, the Philippines finally gained its independence from the United States after almost 50 years of colonial rule. The local elites who inherited the state needed this data for their nation-building project, as communication was one of their main areas of concern. Using these data, I examine how the local elites have imagined Filipinos as mass media audiences. I suggest that such performative imaginings have informed the increasingly authoritarian tendencies of the local elites running the post-colonial state. These tendencies manifested most extremely during the corrupt and violent regime of Ferdinand Marcos from 1965 to 1986. More than previous presidents, Marcos and his wife Imelda would use this data to identify and to measure the audiences of their spectacles and campaigns. As I chart the material and political intersections between audience exposure research and the nation-building project during the early decades of the Sovereign Republic, I foreground the disciplinary interventions of the state in the everyday lives of Filipinos. Not just how they would access or would be reached by the major communication platforms, but also how Filipinos would relate to each other, their political leaders, and to the notion of the nation, how they would perform their citizenship, how they would remember their history, how they would organize their living spaces and working schedules and familial obligations, how they would consume, how they would make love, how they would imagine. In developing this project, I realize it is crucial to bring in the multiple publics of and in my research to address the question of audiences reflexively and collectively. So for my Public Scholars Initiative project, I am creating and curating an online exhibition of visualizations based on data on mass media audiences. Using digital humanities tools, I will be transforming this data into graphs, trees, and maps. So supplementing this displays will be text, images, sounds, and other ephemera generated by the local mass media. This displays will also excerpt historical narratives from my dissertation. In this chart, for instance, I am poring over national housing census data between 1948 and 1990 to trace the differential and intermittent increase of radio ownership among the different regions in the Philippines. And I am using this chart to underscore the uneven reach of and unequal access to the radio, the most common communication platform during this period. How did these disparities affect the ways in which the people living across 7,107 islands relate to the imagined community? While it is open to everyone, this exhibition will particularly target the audiences who have been represented in this data. Some of them are still alive and living in the Philippines, while others are scattered among the various diasporas, Filipino diasporas around the world. The publics of this exhibition will be global. This exhibition will also be interactive. It will have spaces for you to comment on these visualizations. You will also be asked to answer questions posed by the exhibition, respond to provocations from other visitors, and reflect on your continuing engagements with all forms of media. These discussions will become part of the exhibition itself. Through these discussions, I will draw the exhibition audiences into a shared critical space in which you could imagine, you could examine your positions, memories, and performances as audiences. I hope this project will serve as a counterpoint to the disciplinary imperatives that have driven previous studies on audiences in the Philippines and elsewhere. My ultimate aim is to foster a more democratic dialogues among the various critical publics of my research. I will end this presentation by leaving you with another question to think about. How do you perform your role as audiences? Thank you to the Public Scholars Initiative for their support, and thank you all for allowing me to address you as my audiences for today. Good afternoon.
And the final student speaker of today. This is an event on culture, and we come now to the very thing that makes culture possible, and that's language. Our next speaker will be talking about language, and she may not need that much introduction, to be honest, but I will try anyway. She's a renowned environment and culture activist who, at the age 12, gave a talk at the Rio Summit in 1992 and nailed it. So if you haven't seen that, it's on YouTube, and she has been nailing since 1992. Now, among other things, she works with BC's Haida Gwaii community to help the transmission of the local and the endangered language, Zydeco, to future generations. Did I pronounce that correctly? Haida Kill. Please welcome Seven Kawa Suzuki from Anthropology.
Well, thank you, Efe. And I must say, I am just so honored to be up here along with this cohort. It's absolutely fantastic. And I want to congratulate the Public Scholars Initiative for bringing all these people together, and it makes me inspired about the direction of scholarship, definitely. So, oh no, I lost three of my slides. Thank you. Pecha Kucha is a bit stressful. This is my first one. So hello everyone, my name is Severin Kullis Suzuki, and my current work and research is about Haida Kill, the Haida language of the Haida people from Haida Gwaii. And I myself am very much a newcomer to this land. My blood is from Japan and England, and I was born and raised here in Vancouver. But I am very deeply connected with the Haida Nation. I hope that it is going forward. But I am very deeply connected with the Haida Nation. I was ceremonially adopted into the Qadas Qaqiluwai clan when I was 15 years old. My Haida name is Kishkulakaya, and I eventually married a man from Skidigit, Judson Brown, and have moved to Haida Gwaii, and this is where I live with my family. Acknowledgements. I'm very grateful to be studying on unceded territory of the Musqueam Nation. I'm very grateful to several mentors, Gwaganad, Diane Brown, B. Harley, Ilda Gwaii, as well as Dr. Patricia Shaw, who is my supervisor here at UBC. And I'm very grateful for all of the funding that I've received from various agencies. A little background on how I'm here. I am very lucky to have two educations in my life. The first is a scientific education. I come from a very sciencey family, very focused on physics, chemistry, as well as genetics. Here I am doing science. I also was very lucky to have an education from Indigenous friends and family my entire life. And I really benefited from what I feel like were the two eyes that
allowed my left and right brain to really be cultivated and coming together. And I really believe that these two eyes can access, these two perspectives can help us bring into focus a vision for addressing the problems of the 21st century. And I did my master's of science research with Dr. Nancy Turner, as well as Chief Kwaksi Stala as Adam Dick. And really, these two perspectives came into focus for me. But then I moved to Haida Gwaii and became involved in Haida language. The Haida language exists on Haida Gwaii. It is a language isolate. It's unrelated to any other language on Earth. There are three dialects that have survived the cultural genocide. And I'm very grateful for the preservation that the elders of Skidigit have done. These are the elders of Ship. And I want to play for you a little bit of the language. I hope it works. Oops.
Haide kilnai gif kalang. Ka ayas kinaki gudungais ku hidas. Ka haide kil kayas it's the singwagatkin. Haide kil it's the gagu raska. Haide yaki squanang giu it startle. Kaya raganu. Skagilda Haida Kilnai Kastelgan.
And I may need you to play this one too, please. Thank you.
The concern of the elders is that once the fluent Haida speakers pass away, the Haida language would be lost from us. We wish to remain true Haidas always. That is why
they opened Skagilda Haida Kilnai, which is a house where the last speakers of the Haida language come together to record. And today there's 23 speakers of this language left. Almost all of them are in their 80s. So it's a crucial moment. Now there are many programs in Skidigit that have been involved in Haida language revitalization. So they're quickly listed here. And I've been very involved in three of them in the last 3 years. They're highlighted here, the Haida Language Diploma Program, Language Nest, and Mentor Apprentice Program. And this work will be the main core part of my PhD research. When I moved to Haida Gwaii, I wanted to learn Haida so that I could teach my children. And I started apprenticing with Ilda Gwaii B. Harley, who is the matriarch of the Qadiska Qigawai clan. And I used the master apprentice method, which is a very powerful method bringing together elders and younger learners to learn the language in a natural transmission. And so I'm very passionate about this technique. I've been able to run workshops in other communities like Hot Springs Cove on the Master Apprentice method, as well as starting a program on Haida Gwaii, and we have 6 teams that are currently running. As well, a second program has been the Language Nest that Gwagana, Diane Brown, and myself started 2 years ago and continues today. And this is a program that brings together mothers, babies, and elders to try to create an immersion environment to get the exposure that doesn't exist today of the Haida language. As well, this is a very exciting program, the Haida Language Diploma Program, which is a partnership between the Skidigit Band Council and the University of Northern British Columbia. And this is the future of the Haida language. These women have come together to take responsibility for the future of the language. The Truth and Reconciliation has an incredible report and calls to action to all of us in so many different ways. But there are specific calls to action for academic institutions, including Section 16. We call upon post-secondary institutions to create university and college degree diploma programs in Aboriginal languages. As an academic ally, I believe there is a responsibility for academic institutions to be part of the reversal of cultural genocide that we've seen in this country. Not only that, this is a time of enormous potential. This is a time, at a crucial moment in the life of languages on the coast, for the ivory tower to really make a difference. Orange Shirt Day is a way of talking about cultural genocide. It is now in all the schools in September, and last year, my son came home from school and he said, "Mom, are you a First Nations?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Oh, you're one of those takeover guys." And I was absolutely speechless. And it, you know, he's right. And this really just clarified for me the situation that we're in, that my very family is in. Yes, I am one of those takeover guys. And yes, my husband and our family are also First Nations. And I really feel that this reality of family, in fact, reflects the reality of Canada. That, yes, Canada is full of takeover guys, and yes, Canada is full of Indigenous people, and because of the land of Canada, we are forced to live together. We are family, like it or not. And so I'm here at UBC in this spirit, so that my language and my PhD contributes to this reconciliation of the Canadian family. Thank you very much.
So I'd like to invite the last three speakers back to the stage, including Severn. And I don't think we have time for the 1 minute discussion at the moment, so we can directly continue with questions right now.
Memory is the theme that connects all these talks, not only the last three ones, but also all of the talks today. So what are your thoughts on the concept of memory for your work? Who'd like to begin?
Thank you very much for the question. And so part of the qualitative research of going to Toronto, and I didn't mention that Montreal is another site of my study, is to look at the pioneers who actually began the field, probably in the late 70s, early 80s. And a lot of the work of professional theater artists at that time was not documented. So sitting down and having interviews with the predecessors of the field not only creates a kind of social cultural history, but creates a foundation for professional theater history. And because certain groups haven't been documented as readily as the European canon, then memory serves a tremendous, it's a rich resource for moving forward in terms of documenting our cultural history.
One of the things that really fascinates me working with an oral language, so a language that hasn't been written down until this generation, is how our actual neurological memories actually function differently in a literate society, not only a literate society, but now a digital society. And when I speak with elders, and some of the elders that I've been privileged to study with, do not write language, and yet they are very scholarly in their understanding of dialects and different languages. And their minds, their brains, work differently than mine. Their capacity for memory far exceeds anything that I will ever possess. And it's because in oral times, in traditional times, people were trained to remember. It was certain people's jobs to remember. People had different techniques of remembering, and textiles in some communities are as an example of this different kind of memory, this different kind of literacy that we just don't have. And so it's just really been a privilege and fascinating to think about how now in the 21st century, by and large, we're moving to a different way of remembering, a different way of understanding the world because of our literacy, and now because of our digital literacy. This is fundamentally different from human civilization that have existed up until this time.
I have 2 points to say to address your question. The first is, I'm actually using statistics as prompts for memories, and my background's not in statistics. My background is in theater and performance studies as well. But when I saw this, when I saw these primary sources, I was challenged. Like, how could we use statistics to actually pursue humanistic questions. The second is, in my dissertation, I'm commenting on the disposability of big data. This was big data before the term was actually coined. And when I found these primary sources, they were actually discarded. They were no longer, they were no longer being used. And so I'm thinking, you know, with the big data that's collected right now, I mean, you know, in 5-10 years, you know, will we discard this data as well? How can we actually repurpose them to remember?
Time for one more question, maybe. Well, let's thank the presenters. We'd like to conclude by reminding you of two things. I'll be inviting Susan in a second to give the closing remarks, but the PhD's Go Public Research Talk Series are continuing. The next event, there's an error here. We changed the event date to April 12th. So if you could mark your calendars for that. Researching for Social Justice, or Searching for Social Justice, is going to be at the Public Library at 6:30 p.m. On April 12th. I'll be sending out the emails for that. And the final one of this year will be on May 4th, Advancing Health and Inclusion. It's also going to be after work hours. So thank you very much for coming and being a part of this conversation. And I would like to end by inviting Susan to share the closing remarks with us. Thank you.
Thanks, Efe. What a fabulous afternoon. Thank you so much. And I think I was thinking about some commonalities, and I came up with the same one, memory and preservation, and how these young, well, relatively young people are using their brains and their hearts and their minds to tackle this important thing of preserving, of maintaining, of, but not in a stagnant, static way, but in a living way. And how much hope we have for the future that these students are so passionate, engaged, and smart in what they're doing. And I also thought about the varieties of scholarship that they're using. I talked a little bit about at the beginning. People are discovering new things. These students are transforming knowledge. These students are mobilizing not just knowledge, but they are mobilizing and preserving. They are mobilizing stories. They are mobilizing knowledge. They are mobilizing art. They are mobilizing culture. And it's just a wonderful diversity. So, and the one last thing that I noticed about every single person up here is how passionate they were and how much of what they were doing was coming from themselves, from their own history, from their own talents. And again, there's a certain extra energy and love and passion that goes with that, and it makes it all the more delightful. So thank you all so much. Wonderful.